So we are in session 15 today, and we'll continue with statements. And in this session, we will look into the custom exception handling, nested try catch blocks, and exception handling for non-CLS exceptions, and checked and unchecked statements. We'll see what they are and how they can be used, and what are the significance of between them using them. And the fixed statement, we'll see what it is. And we'll look into the system.threading.thread class overview, and also with an example, how can we use a threading program. So not a too much deep dive into that, but a kind of overview of what is a thread and how can we use this namespace and to write a multi-thread applications. And we'll see lock statements in conjunction with the thread, and many other topics. So let's kick off session 15 and get into the details. Okay, so we'll see the next step in the exception handling. Okay, the next step, we did this demo, and next step is the nested try catch. So again, the nested try catch is going to have a try within a try. So in this case, if you see, there are two tries. There is one outer try and catch, and there is an inner try and catch. Okay, so when you can still do this, you can have a nested try catch blocks within, there's no limit. You can go into any number of level having the try catch blocks, but so the scope of the respective try catch need to be understood. So in this case, within first try, I have two try catch blocks. Okay, the first one is here. Okay, so this is the outer one, and then comes the inner one, and also we have the inner two. So so in this case, we have two nested try catch. So one at the top level and the two at the second level. So what happens in this case is the scope in which the try catch block exists does matter. So if any exception occurs within this try block, then the respective catch block will be visited. In this case, I'm actually throwing it. So when you throw the exception, what happens? It will be caught by the outer try catch block. Okay, so if you, in this case, if you handle this and log it to a flat file or a console, you don't throw the exception, then it is suppressed there. So it won't come out of the try block. So in this very demo, what we're doing is we are doing the in.pass in the first try catch and the arithmetic operation in the second try catch block. And also, when I'm doing the int parse, which is a data type conversion, I'm handling it as generic exception, which is a very generic one. So if you see the order, generic one came top and the specific one came down. So it is again respective to the individual try catch blocks. So within this, I can actually have my generic exception on top and also specific one at the bottom, because it's specific to the respective try catch blocks. And in the second case, we had a specific exception wherein it is handling the divide by zero, in which in this case, I'm pretty sure that this is an exception that can happen here. So what happens if the overflow exception happens, which is again an arithmetic exception? In that case, that exception is not handled here. So what happened? It will not be handled here. It will be handled by the outer try catch block. Okay. So that's the key thing, and we'll demonstrate that in action. Okay. So straight away. So we'll walk through this code again here, and we'll see this stuff. Okay, so this top part is a specific one, since because we are actually doing a system.exception. It's a very generic, any exception can be caught here. And in this case, in dot pass, if I pass in any alphabets or special characters other than number, it's going to fail and give me a string to number conversion error. And that's a system.format exception. And similarly, in this try catch block, I'm handling a specific divide by zero exception. And in this case, if the divide by zero occur, this exception will be handled here. And since, if you notice, I'm not throwing it in this case. And whereas in this case, I'm throwing it. Okay. And the respective console.writeLine will tell me where the exception has occurred. So in this case, the below generic exception occurred in nested try, okay, and caught. Similarly, the divide by zero occurred in nested try. That's the indication for us that this particular statement got visited. And the outer cache block will tell me that divide by zero caught and occurred and caught. And similarly, the generic exception will tell you that it's an outer exception block. Okay, we'll try this, run this code. And in the first instance, what I'm going to do is do a happy path, give 10 and 2, which is perfect. And I want to redo the program. Remember, the retry is handled in the finally block. So we are doing that in the finally block. And this would you like to try again is from the finally block. That indicates that finally block will be visited irrespective of an exception or no exception. Okay, so in this case, I'm going to fail it deliberately passing in alphabets, in which case this part should fail. And let's see which try catch will handle it. I'll say 10. And if you see, there are the below generic exception occurred in nested try. Remember that. That means it is system.format exception occurred. And again, we see the next level of catch, which is the below generic exception occurred and caught. Okay, that is a format exception. So if you see, these are two levels of exception. Both the cache blocks got visited. The reason being the throw statement. Because we have a throw, it is actually gone. The exception got bubbled up to the higher level, which is the outer try cache block. And both the cache blocks got visited. Okay, so in the second case, I want to redo again, and in the second case, what I'll do is I will not do the format one. I'll give you the correct values, but I will give a zero. So in this case, if you see, the divide by zero exception occurred in nested try, but it didn't. The outer exception block did not occur because the throw statement is not there. Okay, so it's pretty clear, we can do a debug so that you will have a clear idea how the execution flow goes in. Okay, so I did yes, and then of course we will come to this line by pressing F10. Okay, so I'm going to put a wrong one, say 10 again. So the exception occurred. So what happened? It wrote to the console and then throw statement got visited, and then it went back to the outer exception block where the generic exception got caught. And so that's how we, and again, if the finally block is visited, and we are back to where we are. So we see the two catch blocks, one inner nested try and one outer, got visited. And now okay, so this is still in okay, I will take it from here. I will put a breakpoint where we actually need. I will add a breakpoint here. We'll try the second scenario, and I'll say F5, which is run, and we'll take 10 and 0. So in this case, the divide by zero should occur, right? There you go. So we have the divide by zero And in this case, we don't have a throw statement. So in that case, it didn't bubble up to the outer try catch, but it went back to the outer finally block. See, the finally block is always guaranteed to execute, irrespective of if the exception occurred or not. So that's all about the nested try catch. So similarly, you can have any number of levels like this. And remember, although it supports more number of levels you're going to add, your code readability will go for a toss. So try to not to have n number of levels, level of try catch blocks. It is, although it works good, your code readability will go for a toss, and people will not understand your code easily if you have so many try catch blocks. Okay, and that's the same thing with the VB.NET also. You can also do the same thing with the nested try catch block. Okay, so the next important thing, the custom exceptions. So we have seen all the predefined exception, which is the automatic exception, format exception as an examples. So what if you want to have your own exception? Say for example, you are doing some kind of a database operation, and at a given situation, say that you're trying to violate a constraint or a business rule, say business rule exception for example. So in your application, you can have a business rule exception, data access layer exception, or a presentation layer exception, and so on. So you can have a module specific exceptions also, like you have financial module and you can have define a financial exception. So it depends upon your application or your company name and all. So how can we do that? We'll do it now. So in this case, if you see, all it matters is that your custom exception is inherited. This is my custom exception. This is my custom exception that can be of any name because this is a simple class. And this is inheriting system.exception. Okay? And this is the key thing. Colon is the operator used for inheritance. So all we need is your class need to inherit system.exception, that's all. And remember, system.exception is a concrete class, so it doesn't have any members that you need to override and implement. It doesn't have any abstract members, it's just a system.exception. And what it means, as long as you inherit here, we are done. We don't have to do any additional stuff there. But since to make a difference between a system.exception and my exception, this example is trying to introduce two new properties to my exceptions, because we have seen there are useful methods and properties available in system.exception, but of course they are limited. So in my custom exception, I want to have introduce a couple of new properties and attributes, so that it makes sense to my business. In simple example, this is a typical example in the real-time world, wherein every application will have an error codes and error messages, and each of the error messages can be associated to an error code. So this my custom exception has two members. One is a error code, which is an error, one is an error code, another one is an error message. Okay, to be very simple. And what I did additional here is I'm actually overloading the constructor here. So I'm actually having my own constructor here, and this is again a new thing probably for you. So here what I'm doing is this is a my custom exception. The name of this method is actually matching the name of the class, so that means this is a constructor, and that too it doesn't have any parameters within it, so it is a default constructor with the default values. So we are trying to initialize with the default values. And if you remember carefully, observe this colon base open brackets and close brackets. This is actually calling the base class constructor. Okay, so this is how, if you want to call the base class constructor or base class method, all we need is make a colon base call. And similarly, this is a parameterized constructor. The reason why I'm calling the my base or base class constructor, because the other related attributes or properties that are associated to system or exception need to be anyway initialized. So once I write my own constructor, so that base constructor also need to be called to make sure the system not exception works as it should. And similarly, I have a custom parameterized constructor wherein I'm taking the error code as a parameter and also error message. Okay, fair enough. So whenever people create this exception, they can straight away pass the error code and error message and then create the exception and throw it out. Okay, that's the overview of the my custom class. And now the next step. Step 2 is the class which is going to make use of this exception. Okay, so in this case, it's a my error. This is my, consider this as a my business class. Wherein it is making use of the custom exception. Okay, so this is a my error store, just an example, and in this case it has a and I have a constructor which is taking the error code and the error message, so that we are initializing the error code, error store, my error store. This is just a business data that is coming in. I'm trying to simplify it to demonstrate, so that's the reason I just took this route. If at all it is confusing with this having the same properties and as an error code and error message to that of an exception, my custom exception, then let me know. You don't get confused. That is different and this is different. So probably I would have given a different example, like a person class or a car class here. So that would have been an ideal example, but for now, consider this as a business class, and it is just having a business data within it. And within the within this method, this is a public method wherein say it's validate, right? So we have passed, you initialize your business class with the business data and then say call the validate method. And what validate will do, it will fire the business rules on your business class. In typically, a typical business domain object will look like this exactly, that it has a business data like this, and it might expose, in this case, so these are properties, of course, this is, since they have getters and setters, these are properties, not fields. Fields won't have getters and setters, remember that. And they are public, so you have these properties, which is business data, and a constructor which can initialize it, and then call the validate method before you do any database operation. So in this validate method, we are actually checking the business rules. In this case, the simple business rule is if the error code is not zero, not equal to zero, and if the error message is not null or empty, then we're throwing the my custom exception, because in this my custom exception is actually taking two of the parameters. So we're trying to invoke the parameterized constructor here and the default constructor here. Hope that is clear. And this is what's happening. The my custom exception is the exception that we have defined in the step 1. Okay, so now comes to the step 3. So this is a block wherein the program is going to be making use of your business class, which is your error store, whatever. So in this case, what I'm doing here is I'm taking the input from the command line. It's same using the get input, enter a valid error code and enter a valid error message, and we are taking both of them and creating the instance of the my business class, which is the error store, which is my error store, and which is passing the error code and error message. So after that, I'm calling the validate method, and if you see, this is within the try catch block, a try block, sorry. So when the validate call is called, what happens here is actually checking the business rule and throwing the custom exception. So till this part, it's the same way as I'm handling the system.exception. So only difference is in the catch block, I will be more specific in saying that I'm going to call the my custom exception as a EX under catch. Okay, under catch, I'm going to see this is the namespace. So the exception type, and I'm handling that here. So that's how we're going to make use of the custom exception. Okay, so that's hope that is clear enough. It's pretty straightforward and simple. Nothing complicated there. Okay, we will do, and this is what the validate method is, nothing but the implementation is given here, and the my custom exception here is what thrown in from the validate method. Okay, so we'll do a quick demo. So the nested one, we're done, so I'm going to take this off. Okay, yeah, this is my custom exception. So it's properly organized code here, and we have an error code. We have just two properties. One is an error code property, wherein we have the local variable declared and then handled it. And also we have a error message as a property implementation here. If you remember, this is a typical implementation of the encapsulation principle of object-oriented programming, wherein you have the private member got exposed using a public member. And those are the two properties we have. And the constructors, we have the base here. It's initializing the base class. Initializing the default constructor and calling the base class, the base system.exceptions constructor. So in this case, we are initializing the error code to 100 and error message to unknown. Okay, that's a default constructor behavior. And similarly, the parameterized constructor is taking whatever you're passing in and initializing the respective member. So if you see carefully, there is a system.exception, although you inherited, there is nothing specific to a system.exception that you need to implement here. So it's open. These are all, even if you don't do any of these, it will still work as your custom exception, right? In this case, we just added additional properties just like any class. So we have seen the my custom exception implementation there. And next we'll go into the usage of the custom exception. So in this class, this is an okay custom exception implementation, and in this this is the same get input method, which is going to take the input from the end user. And okay, so void main, I'm going to uncomment. So in this example, so here it's the same thing, retry mechanism I have as a label there, and capturing the same in the finally block if you want to retry and all. So most important aspect here is the custom exception. So we have the system.exception as a generic, which followed later, and the first immediate exception I'm catching here is the my custom exception. Here I'm taking the error code and error message as an input parameter input. So in this case, I'm directly initializing the my error store, my business object, with those values, and I'm invoking a validate. So when the validation is successful, it or irrespective of what, it's going to throw an exception. Either it could be a default constructor or parameterized constructor in other case. So all it matter is either you'll get the unknown exception or the known exception. So what will happen if I put zero here and a message as something? No. Okay, what it says, it's unknown, because we check that if the error code is zero, then it's going to be a unknown exception. It's a default constructor. Okay, I want to retry this again. and I will say error code as 500, and I'll say hello. Hello custom exception. And I see 500 and hello custom exception. So this is handled in the my custom exception. Okay, so now what will happen if I break this like this? So there it goes with the system.format exception, wherein the below generic exception got caught, which is part of this. We'll have a breakpoint here. Okay, and then run this again. Okay, so I'll say why. That means I want to enter a invalid number there. So it jumped directly to the system.exception. Okay, and if I do say 400 and then the next statement, which is again F10, next statement is say some text. Okay, so what will happen now, we'll see. So once you validate, we got an exception and it caught in the my custom exception. Okay, so this is how the custom exception can be implemented and used in the application code. So a typical usage, right, if I have a custom exception for my business rules and I handle this exception like this way, so if my business rules exception happens, then I want to do certain number of tasks. Okay, so that's how you're trying to achieve it here. Using the system-driven exceptions, you can never say that it's a business exception, right? So this way you can ensure that some exception has occurred during my business rules validation, and you can treat them specially, like mask it with a user-friendly exception or log it to some a specific business specific log file, or report this exception to a special case or someone else or whatever. You can do treat it a number of ways based on the policy or the application requirements. And similarly with the data access application, also if anything happens with the data access layer, you can handle that specific exceptions as separately. So that's a very, very important feature. So irrespective of what type of application you're working on, exception is not an exception, or I mean to say it cannot be avoided. There is always a need to do exception handling. If you don't do an exception handling in your program, then you can never move forward. So this should be taken seriously. So the next topic we have with respect to the exception handling is the non-CLS exceptions. So non-CLS, CLS, if you remember, we had this introductory sessions. CLS stands for Common Language Specifications, which is the non-.NET exceptions. Or to be more specific, exceptions that are not derived from system.exception. Okay, so what can be exception that is not derived from a system.exception? There are multiple cases. In this one of the example, good example here is if you have a C++ code that you're trying to use. So if any exception that C++ program can raise, like a QAM component or any other third-party DLL that you're trying to use in .NET code, and if that breaks, it is not going to give you an exception which is inheriting or from the system.exception. So such exceptions are called as a non-CLS exception. And how do you handle the non-CLS exception? That's a special case. Since we see that catch is always going to take a system.exception. So how do we handle them? So we can handle them in a special way. .NET language wraps all such exceptions into a system.exception. So that's the feature of a .NET runtime, to wrap such non-system.exceptions into a special type of exception called the runtime wrapped exception. Okay, if you see this is a runtime wrapped exception. In this case, in this typical example, what we did here is if and else. So we catch it as a normal exception, catch system.exception E, and what happens internally is if any such exception occurs, then we can get transform that into a runtime wrapped exception. If the runtime wrapped exception, again, runtime wrapped exception is again a .NET exception, okay? So it's a special type of exception which will wrap the non-system.exception exceptions, okay? So this runtime, this will again fall under the system.exception. That's how we are getting that information from the system.exception E, right? Within this catch block, we are getting the E. So here, this is a new operator, as operator. If you carefully observe, this is a new operator. So this in VB.NET, you use this same as keyword to create a variable, right? So dim XYZ or I as integer, you use the as keyword. In C sharp, the meaning for as is completely different. It is not used for to declare a variable, or it is used to convert a variable, convert a given variable to a given data type. So it is a cast operation in C sharp. People do ask what is as in C sharp. Okay, so again, that's a good thing to remember. So in this typical example, what we're trying to do here is we are actually converting or typecasting system.exception to runtime wrapped exception. Okay, so that's what this statement means. And we are actually here, if you see, we have declared RWE as a variable of type runtime wrapped exception. Okay, this is again falls under the system.runtime wrapped exception. So if you see the is equal to operator right hand side part, the E is the parameter, which is the system.exception that has occurred right now. And then we are typecasting that to a runtime wrapped exception. Okay, so what will happen? If the cast operation is successful, it's going to give you the runtime wrapped exception into RWE. Otherwise, it is going to give null. It is not going to raise an error. That's important thing. Okay, so what we are doing immediately after that, we are checking if RWE is not null. That means you have got the wrapped exception. Okay, the wrapped exception is a property inside the RWE, which RWE is your runtime wrapped exception. So since you're able to convert into RWE, which is runtime wrapped exception, it has a member called wrapped exception, within which you'll have the text saying it is a, in general here it is an object, but we are typecasting that into string. Here also we are using the as keyword. So if this type conversion is successful, then we get the actual message into S string. And again, we're checking if the S is not null, then control mean show it. And since we don't have any C++ or any other than non-.NET code here, I cannot demonstrate this specific code. Okay, and another important thing is the runtime wrapped exception is available in this namespace, which is system.runtime.compilerservices. Okay, so we are good for now. And yes, another key thing here is when we do this operation, the assembly need to be notified that they are using the assembly attribute, saying that runtime compatibility attribute. So wrapped non-exception throws is equal to true. So it's going to actually be non-exception, which is non-system exceptions, will be wrapped and throw. And when you set this to true, then only this can happen. Otherwise, by default, it cannot be wrapped into the runtime wrapped exception. So this is a prerequisite that need to happen. Okay, and then we come to the checked or unchecked statements. This goes in the context of handling the numeric operations or arithmetic operations, wherein we have seen another exception under the system.arithmetic exception called the overflow exception, right? The overflow exception occurs when you exceed, we're trying to assign a value to a variable exceeding its max length. Okay, in simple example, I would say, okay, so if you take a case like this, what is this byte? Okay, byte B is equal to, its max size is actually 255, right? It can take only up to 255. What will happen if I put 257? So this is what overflow happens. So at this case, what happens? The value a byte can take exceeded the value that been assigned to it. And in this case, the system overflow exception occurs. So the checked and unchecked scenarios are used in that context. In this code example, if you see the code, and of course, the, just to complete what we have on the top, the slash checked compiler option is again a key thing there. So if you don't use the checked or unchecked context or the keywords or statement in your context, the behavior will be default, and the behavior, default behavior, is again depends upon the compiler option that you give when you compile it as a slash checked. If you say checked, then it's as good as applying the overflow checks on every assignment operations that happens in the program. Okay. Okay, there we go. So here is the typical example we are taking as a short, as a data type, and this is a 32767 is the max value a short can take. And we're trying to exceed it by using the math operation, right? So here, what we're having is int z. Okay, z is having the context declared as unchecked here. And what we're trying to do is adding both x and y and typecasting that output to short. So the arithmetic operation might be successful, and while you typecast it, so using an unchecked statement. So in this case, it's unchecked. So you don't check if it is overflowing. That's what you mean to say. So don't check if this is overflowing. Please continue. So in that case, what happens? The if it overflows, it's going to truncate. Okay. And in this case, we are not using it, right? Using without checked or unchecked, in this case, the default behavior will come into play. That means if you're applying the slash checked compiler option, that will proceed over this. Otherwise, it's going to be completely default. It can be, it will throw your exception called the overflow exception. And the last one goes in with the checked exception. So in this case, specifically, we are putting in the try catch block, so that we are ensuring that you check the overflow operation here. If this overflows, then throw an exception. Don't take it for granted. Okay, so that's what this means. That's why you have a try and catch block. Okay, so in this case, let's see what's going to happen. So this is a pretty much an output. We can of course run it and see. Okay, we'll do a quick demo. Make sure we get rid of this. And yep, here we go. Well, this is a pretty simple. So I just compare to the slide. It's a little more organized code I have. What I'm trying to do here is making a method with checked. So this is a checked. I'm just named the method name so that we see a proper output outside. And in this case, it's going to throw an exception when I'm doing a check, right? And the method without with unchecked. And this is the unchecked context, wherein I'm using the try catch block still, okay? But the unchecked should will not throw an exception in this case. And the third one is the without with the default behavior, wherein we're not doing any typecasting. So this operation will strictly depend upon the slash checked compiler option when you build this. So we are calling three of those methods, with checked, with unchecked, and with default. So let's run this. So we see the typical behavior with unchecked. So here, the first instance, we are actually using checked. Because we are using checked, it actually checked the overflow and throw the overflow exception. And the second case, we have unchecked, so it doesn't throw an exception, but the value is not predictable. -2 is some number, but it doesn't throw an exception. So in that case, your value is not guaranteed to be accurate at a given time, right? So this the third case is again unchecked because I didn't put any compiler option called check, right? So that's about the checked and unchecked, which is pretty simple. Some folks around will ask about checked or unchecked. And fixed is another interesting thing. Okay, a fixed statement prevents relocation. Remember, relocation. This is a very good one. If you need to go back to the garbage collector GC examples that we have been we discussed in the previous sessions. So relocation is a one thing. So if you remember the mark sweep algorithm in garbage collector, so what happens here is the mark, when it marks the objects in the garbage, it will be sweeped by the sweep algorithm. It's going to reclaim the memory, and then finally comes the compact operation. This is the third operation. During the compaction, what happens? It's going to try to rearrange the objects in the memory by moving the objects from one place to other, right? In general, it's trying to do the defragmentation of the memory. So in that operation, what happens? The objects are going, it's trying to keep the related objects to sit side by side, so that it's going to reduce the memory IO operation and memory hit rate and give you the highest performance possible. So during the movement, you don't want some of the objects to be moved. If you remember, there was one of the tip that was given that pinning is one of the feature, like you can pin an object at a given address so that your garbage collector don't move it during the compaction. How would this will help? Say for example, you're using a class or a member in context of a COM operation, like an application outside the unmanaged code, like you pass the handle of a given class instance in the memory to another program running outside the CLR. So in that case, if a garbage collector moves your class instance in the memory, then the other program will go for a crash because it's trying to reach that object in the memory, but it cannot able to reach it. So in that case, whenever you're dealing with such operations wherein the memory should not, the object in the given memory should not be moved, in that case, you will use the statement called fixed. So a fixed statement is used in C# to achieve the pinning behavior. It's like a pinning, like a dashboard pin. You put a note on the dashboard and put a pin. Similarly, it is a pin a object in the given address so that your garbage collector will not move those objects from memory during compaction. This can be used only with the unsafe code. Again, that's a key thing to remember. Okay, so we'll do a quick demo. VB.NET doesn't support it, and at a high level, VB.NET does not support unsafe code. It's possible only with C#. Okay, so this is the case we are using, making use of it. There is some compiler error. It doesn't see a point. Okay, so there is a point here. We got commented out. Okay, now it's good. So we'll do a debug mode. Okay, we just start taking a point and X and Y is getting initialized and we enter into the fixed context. Okay, so if you see the locals here, the address, we can see the address here, the P as a pointer to this given address. So pay attention there, it's going to be locked there. So that's the pinning behavior is done. So since our example is too short, it doesn't do more than just a square root. Imagine if you're doing 1,000 lines of code within this context. So it's going to make a really big difference. And between that, if the GC comes into play and that too, it try to do a compaction plan and determines that the compaction is necessary and do a compaction algorithm, then that time you will see a difference. Otherwise, it's you cannot see any difference in normal case. Okay, so we're good. So we'll move on. So this code I'm going to comment out. Okay, I will not compile. It's going to creep because there's no main method. So we'll continue with the next slide. Okay, so here comes the interesting point, the lock statement. In VB.NET, sync lock. You use the locking only in system.threading. That means when you do a multi-threaded applications. So here we have a quick introduction with the lock keyword with the multi-threaded application. So you can, this is one of the typical example here demonstrating the lock in context with the multi-threaded application. So I didn't put the whole code here, just only one snippet here, which is making use of the lock statement. In ideal case, what is lock? So lock is going to ensure that if multiple threads are accessing a shared resource, then and trying to update the given shared resource, that situation is called as a critical section. So whenever people talk about critical section, remember, that is related to a multi-threaded application. So wherein you have the same method or same path of execution. Thread is referred to as a path of execution in general. That means any method, if you have a 10 lines of statement or 20 lines of statements, that method can be associated to a thread. So that means you can execute the same method concurrently using n number of threads. So that's so that way you can increase the productivity of your or responsiveness of your program. Everyone knows multi-threaded app is always more robust or more responsive than a single-threaded application. So multi-threaders are very good for very load handling situations. Wherein if you have to process 2 million records, then you can make use of a multi-threaded situation wherein your given algorithm within one method, you can link that given method to a n number of threads and let all the threads start processing simultaneously so that your CPU cycles can be shared across the all the threads and your work can get done faster. It's pretty much like equal, like one person doing the same job versus 10 people doing the same job. So your work will get done 10 times faster. So we are trying to handle the critical section or scenarios wherein the multiple threads are trying to share the same resource and the updates to the given resource need to be synchronized. In this typical example, what I'm trying to do here is typical behavior of a banking transaction wherein we have one account with some initial deposit and we're trying to withdraw the amount from the given bank account using multiple threads. Okay, this is not a real-time example. It can never happen. You never withdraw from your account using a multi-threaded behavior, because you always withdraw one at a time, right? So as a person, it's not like like 100 different people come and withdraw from your account at the same time. That's not going to happen. In the real, this is just to demonstrate to ensure your balance should not go negative, right? So when we're doing this, the balance update activity is a critical section where an n number of threads are trying to withdraw money from the same balance. So if n number of threads are accessing the same resource, we need to ensure that each of the thread looks at the updated copy, updated number, so that whenever it does the business logic saying if the balance is at least equal or greater than the amount that need to be withdrawn, if that business rule satisfies, that means in simple, if you're trying to withdraw $100, system need to ensure that there is a balance of at least $100 or more. If it is less than 100, then you cannot withdraw, right? In that case, it will go to a minus balance. So that's the rule we're trying to enforce, and we're trying to withdraw the balance. In this case, that update behavior, update logic here is a falls under the critical section, wherein this this part especially, whereas balance is equal to balance minus amount, is locked. That means the lock statement will ensure that only one thread can access this method or this block, and if there are n number of threads asking to waiting for access to this block, they will be kept in queue. So soon after the first in the priority wise, if the one thread is there, so that thread will be prioritized, and only one thread at a time will access to this locked context. So that's how it's going to be ensured that the balance is not going to be minus. Okay, if imagine without lock. All threads can do the balance. So for example, at a given situation, balance is 1000. At the same time, if 10 threads are trying to withdraw the same $500 each, then all of the 10 threads can withdraw 500, but still there will be a 500 balance, or it can go to a minus balance also. So we're not sure how it's going to happen. Behavior is going to be weird. And using sync lock in VB.NET, you can achieve or you can handle the critical section behavior. Okay, hope you understood what I meant. Now we will see how can you write a multi-thread application. So we have a pretty good example here. I will show you now. Okay, so this code, what are we doing here? So this is a bank account wherein we have a balance as a private member, and I'm just putting this random number. Okay, probably this is again a new statement for you. Random is a class that's going to give you a random number. So you can actually turn it into a 4 digits or 5 digits or based on your need. So if you, we'll see in this case, I just converted that into a 4 digit. Let me show you the code where I'm doing it. So the intention here is to withdraw a random number instead of a fixed number. Okay, so here what happens is the random number dot next will give you the number, and in this case we are actually getting the only 3-digit number, not the more than that. Okay, because my balance itself is initialized with the $1000 here. This okay, and in this case I'm actually trying to withdraw numbers less than 100 at a time. Okay, that's what this statement means. Okay, you can actually try out using the random in different ways and see for yourself. It's going to be very cool and very useful also. Okay, in this case we have the constructor account, and the it takes the balance as a parameter. It's a parameterized constructor, and the withdraw implementation here. So withdraw is actually returning an int. Int is pretty much, it could be a byte, of course. What it's doing, it is going to say whether the withdrawal is successful or not. And withdraw functionality here is checking for if the balance is less than zero, then it's not going to allow you. It's simply actually throwing an exception as a negative balance to, because we are in console application, throw it doesn't help. So I'm writing, logging it as a negative balance. So whenever the balance goes below zero, this condition will be satisfied. And the next immediate thing, we're checking the withdrawal aspects, wherein we are using the log statement. So we'll see a clear difference with and without lock just now. So using a lock, this is going to safeguard the critical section, wherein at a given time only one thread can access this. Remaining threads will be in queue. And here we are checking if the balance is above the amount. The amount is the value that is going to be asked to withdraw. The amount is passed. Say I'm going to withdraw $50. And if it is the balance is greater than or equal, then we're going to do the balance withdrawal. Like a balance before withdrawal is balance, I'm trying to print out an amount to withdraw, amount and after withdrawal, and balance after withdrawal, I'm going to put the balance out so that we see how the balance is going on. And in this case, it is successful, so I'm returning 1. And in this case, if it is not, if the balance is not sufficient, then again, I'm returning as 0. So that means I'm not allowing to withdraw. So that's a typical transaction, right? And the do transaction, this is again a member within the account. A do transaction is actually doing for 100 times almost, right? If I is less than 100, we are doing the withdrawal with a random number for 100 times, okay? And so that means 100 means this one stage is definitely going to go. And carefully observe the logic here. There's a key note here. Yeah, within the account class, when I say do transaction, the do transactions itself is trying to withdraw almost 100 times, right? And that's the account implementation. Once I come to the main method, here we do the actual threading implementation, wherein we have created array of 10 threads. Okay, so we see the array concept here within square brackets, and thread is the class we're going to create instance of this using the thread, using a new keyword, and we actually created an array of thread, and the size is initialized to 10. That means we have an array of 10 threads in the identifier called threads. And now I have an account, OBJ account, created with initial balance of 1000. Right, this is a parameterized constructor being called with the 1000 as a parameter or argument passed in. And now we are actually iterating for 10 times and initializing the thread. Okay, so this is how we are associating using a start thread start. So thread t, okay, t is a variable that has been created as a thread. And we are actually associating the array, each of the element member of the array, we are initializing that with the another thread. And the thread T is actually created again using a thread keyword. And it is taking a method. It's pretty much like a delegate. If you remember the delegates, we are actually passing the address of a method to a delegate and invoking a delegate, right? In a thread, thread also similar to that. We said thread is going to be path of execution. That means it's actually going to take a method as a reference, and it's going to run that method whenever you say thread.start. It can be like this also. If this statement is really confusing you, the same statement can be written like this. TS is equal to thread start and pass this do transactions as a parameter to it. Okay, so, and in this case I can pass the, okay, let me comment this out and do it again instead of this new here. Okay, if this helps you to just clarify, right? So all I'm doing is I'm creating a thread start object here, and I'm passing the thread start as a parameter to thread. So thread start is actually associated to the account.doTransactions, and the parameters you want to pass when you do a thread.start. Since doTransaction doesn't take any parameters, your thread.start here doesn't take any parameters. So in this for loop, we actually created 10 threads, okay, and added to the array, which is threads of I, and we are initializing it, and then by using the same iteration of for loop, we are actually starting the threads at the same time. So all of these 10 threads are actually making call to do transaction 100 times each. Okay, so that's what we are doing here. So imagine it's a bulk load that we are adding to this section, right? So this section is being called almost 1,000 times in that operation, and each of the thread is trying to hit it for 100 times. So this is a very big load we are adding it. Okay, we'll see with lock. So with lock, it's a very safe execution. We have seen the balance after withdrawal is zero. So we reached the zero balance and the program ran successfully, and it ensured that the balance, nowhere the balance is gone negative, right? If you see the before balance amount to withdraw is -1, which is a random number that we're trying to pull out. But the balance after withdrawal, if you see balance, all these star symbols, the balance after withdrawal is never zero. Okay, never minus negative value. It went to zero though. Okay, so that's actually it kept although 1,000 times this that block has been hit. It ensured that the business rule is satisfied in all occasions. Okay, so that's the typical behavior of a usage of a lock. It's actually synchronized the critical sections. Now we'll see the behavior or what will happen if I don't have the lock. Okay, we have reached the negative balance far away, right? So the other threads, actually I can't able to see the previous one, but it reached the negative balance so many times, since the negative balance is actually handled here, right? This part has been hit so many times. Okay, so that's the importance of a lock statement, and it is a very good statement, very useful statement in multi-threaded applications. So with this, all the statements we have covered. Session 15, we did cover the, we did continue with the exception handling, especially with the custom exception handling, and all the different steps how to create a custom exception and handle them in three-step process with a very good demo. And also we did see how can we handle a non-CLS exceptions in C#.NET and what are they, the significance about using the system.runtime.compiler services to start with, and how significant they are in handling the non-CLS exceptions. And also we did see what's a checked and unchecked statements in C#.NET, and which is not supported in VB.NET. And we did see a very good demo as well in this context, and we did see a fixed statement. How can we use this in C#.NET, which is not supported in VB.NET? And we did see a lock statement and sync lock in VB.NET with special focus on the multi-threaded applications. We just had an introduction to the system.threading namespace and also created a multi-threaded application to demonstrate the lock and sync lock in C# and Ruby.NET. Okay, so with this, we wind up this session here, and we'll continue with the other topics in the next session.